Great, thank you, and good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to CFR's Masterclass. I'm Shannon O'Neil, and I'll be presiding over our session. So today, our subject is going to be why the US gets blindsided by foreign policy crises again and again, what lessons we've learned from the past, and then hopefully, or perhaps, what we can do to avoid them in the future. So to lead us and guide us through all this, we have Paul Stairs. Many of you know Paul. Paul is the General John W. Vessey Senior Fellow for Conflict Prevention. He's also the director of our Center for Preventive Action. And Paul has written or edited 9 books, variously touching on this very broad subject. And his latest is called Preventive Engagement, How America Can Avoid War, Stay Strong, and Keep the Peace. So all very tall orders there. And he's also been involved at CFR in several task forces and in other places. So he's been thinking about these issues for many years, and we are lucky enough to have him enlighten us, or at least kick us off on the discussion that we will have over the next 45 minutes. So I'm going to turn it over to him to have some opening remarks for about 8 to 10 minutes, and then we'll open it up to all of you for a broader discussion. So please, Paul, go ahead.
Okay, well, thanks, Shannon, and thanks to all of you for joining us in this conversation today. As everybody knows only too well, we're in the midst of a national crisis that originated overseas. Our failure to manage this crisis is mostly due to what we did domestically or didn't do domestically, but part of it also had to do with our preparedness or lack thereof to respond to a foreign health threat or risk to our nation's well-being. We had been aware of this risk for some time. In fact, we even got a foretaste of it, I think, in 2014 with the Ebola crisis. Yet we were still caught off guard and off balance when the coronavirus outbreak started. As a result, we did not respond well in the early days of the crisis. And as you said, Shannon, this is not the first time this happened. There have been many examples, both during the Cold War, but particularly after the Cold War, when we were blindsided or did not react very well to emerging threats abroad. Let me just give you some obvious examples. The Iraqi invasion of Kuwait in 1990, the breakup of Yugoslavia in the early 1990s, the Rwandan genocide, North Korea's nuclear weapons program, various crises between India and Pakistan, 9/11, of course, the Arab Spring uprisings, Russian interventions in Georgia, Ukraine, Syria, the rise of ISIS, cyber attacks, and of course, Russian meddling in the 2016 election. Each time we were to some extent surprised, or if we weren't surprised in terms of the intelligence warnings, we were nevertheless unprepared for those particular events. In many occasions, this led to inquiries or postmortems that usually prompted some reforms to how we collect intelligence or analyze it. This led to some sort of technological fixes and organizational tweaks to improve our early warning and early response capabilities. And this was, I can give some examples. In the 1990s, we had the creation of CIA's Political Instability Task Force with its emphasis on forecasting civil unrest, particularly in fragile and weak states. 9/11, as many of you know, led to the better integration of domestic and foreign intelligence on terrorist threats and the creation of the Department of Homeland Security, as well as the Office of the Director of National Intelligence. The Iraqi WMD debacle led to better tradecraft protocols to avoid groupthink and other analytical biases. And we've also seen in recent years the creation of mission centers at the intelligence community to kind of integrate and focus intelligence collection and tasking and analytical work. Given these precedents, I would not be surprised if a Biden administration carries out its own inquiry in the future on the coronavirus pandemic. Nevertheless, we keep getting blindsided by events overseas, and when we're not strictly blindsided, as I said earlier, we fail to respond adequately. So what I thought I would try to do as to set the conversation up is to briefly explain why this keeps happening, and second, what we might be able to do to lessen it happening in the future. I don't think I have to convince this audience about the need to do this. The The risk environment, if you will, is becoming more complex, more multifaceted. We've got growing competition with great powers, regional instability. There's still the threat of sub-state and transnational actors. And then there's this whole new class of sort of threats that don't derive from human agency, whether they're health threats or environmental sources of danger. Okay, so why does this keep happening? Those who study the problem usually distinguish between failures of intelligence and failures of policy response. The former is a failure essentially of the intelligence community, those invested with warning senior decision makers to warn them of an impending threat in a clear, compelling, and of course timely fashion so that they can respond to neutralize the threat in some way. Intelligence failures, however, can derive from many sources. There could be a failure to gather intelligence on a particular part of the world for a variety of reasons. There can be deliberate efforts by an adversary to conceal its activities. There can be human error in how you interpret ambiguous evidence, such as mirror imaging and other biases. And of course, there's a reluctance to cry wolf too often, otherwise it can undermine the credibility of your warning. And perversely, I think admitting uncertainty can also undermine how seriously decision makers react to your warnings. In contrast, policy failures occur when decision makers fail to respond to the warning they receive. And here the problem is when decision makers are just too busy or too distracted to take on board what they're being told. They also have their own cognitive or political biases that lead them to dismiss warnings or devalue them or somehow otherwise ignore them. And of course, they're also mindful of the costs and consequences of responding to a false warning, which can often deter them from taking early action. So all of this means that there are many reasons why we keep getting blindsided or just don't respond very well. So what should we do in the future? To me, the solution lies with moving away from the mindset that believes that we can tame or significantly reduce strategic uncertainty. To me, it's a kind of holy grail that always seems to be in reach, but we can never quite get hold of it. Instead, we should accept and even embrace the fact that strategic uncertainty is something that can never be eliminated, but only managed and mitigated. This is not to say that I think that trying to improve our intelligence capabilities or the quality of our analytical tradecraft or improving the speed at which we can inform senior decision makers of particular threats is a waste of time and money. It's not, but it can only take you so far. So what do I mean by accepting and embracing strategic uncertainty? So we've basically been following a mindset that really goes back to Pearl Harbor. It's about responding to threats that have already been formed or have been identified with a high degree of confidence that they represent a threat to national security. This means that the early warning, early response mindset is essentially reactive. We're always responding to threats once they have formed, and once we are sure that they actually represent a threat. And that means that they're always subject to these problems, whether it's on the information side or the policy side that I mentioned earlier. So what does this mean in practical terms? And I think I don't want to talk too long, but I can just focus on three, I think, initiatives, and I'd be happy to explain them further in the Q&A. So I think, firstly, we should complement our early warning systems with a dedicated national risk assessment process. And this would take stock of the universe of threats to our security, as well as being able to gauge both their likelihood and, most importantly, their potential impact. And this can be carried out over certain timeframes, short, medium, long term. So why the focus on impact? I believe that the reason is that the only way to make decision makers more sensitive to the information they receive is to convey to them what is at stake. Just telling them that there is some threat in a faraway country, that a coup or crop failure or terrorist incident they should pay attention to, probably won't really make an impact on them. they have to understand why this is of importance to US interests, what could be the second, third, fourth order consequences of that event. And this approach allows you to rank risks and therefore prioritize them. And this is what we do in our annual preventive priority survey. The most serious risk, moreover, can receive more attention, both in terms of intelligence collection as well as analytical work. And to me, it represents the most rational way to task the intelligence community. Secondly, we should design our foreign and security policies in terms of their ability to mitigate external risks, both upstream and downstream. So what do I mean by that? So upstream risk reduction refers to measures that lower the likelihood of the risk materializing, whereas downstream measures are designed to reduce their impact, and particularly their negative impact, if and when they do materialize. By the way, we use this basic approach, this upstream, downstream risk mitigation approach in other areas of public policy, whether it's health risks, public security, public safety, policing, and so on. Finally, and I think this is particularly important, we should professionalize our crisis preparedness. Currently, it's very ad hoc and improvised. Our senior officials receive little or no training in crisis management. If they're lucky, they might take part in an exercise or simulation, but this doesn't happen very often. It typically gets shoehorned into their busy schedules. Often they have to take time out at weekends to do this, which is not great. Moreover, what is learned in these, in real crises, as well as in these exercises, is rarely transmitted or captured, and the lessons learned for subsequent decision makers. The crisis management techniques are not taught in our professional academies. And so we end up more or less approaching every crisis as if they are de novo and new. And so we have to keep reinventing the wheel. So that's basically what I would suggest we need to do. And I'll end there, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
Great. That's a lot for us to work with, and it's a great start. I'm going to ask you the first question, but first I'm going to ask Tegan just to remind people how they can get in the queue to ask their question.
Certainly. Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now button and proceed with your name, affiliation, and question. If you would like to view a roster of the CFR members registered to attend this meeting, please click the link in your Zoom chat box.
Great. Well, you know, I want to dive into sort of how we solve this problem, which you laid out some ideas. But first, I thought I'd go back when you were giving out some of the examples of where we've gotten blindsided. I sort of saw maybe three buckets, and some were, you know, state actors, Pearl Harbor and things like that, where states attacked us. Some were non-state actors, right? So 9/11 and the ads, and others are sort of non-actor actors, right? COVID or perhaps climate change and you know, tornadoes or fires and the things. And so maybe talk a little bit about what are we maybe better at or worse at? Or do these three buckets, does it make a difference if it's a state actor versus a non-state actor versus a non-human actor? And you know, how has that evolved over time? I'd be interested in your take.
Yeah, so that's a terrific point. And you're absolutely right that there are obviously different types of threat. There are different, each of these threats represents different levels of concern too, in terms of the damage or harm they can do to the US. State actors are inherently easier to warn about just because you can observe them better. You can design what they call indicators and warning systems that are kind of like a checkbox in which you can look for identifiable evidence that they're doing certain things that might be threatening to you. And you can sort of pass what they're saying. You can look at what their troops are doing or whether they're being mobilized to do so. So that's clearly the easiest target. That doesn't make it, you know, always guaranteed that we will detect what's going to happen in advance. As I said, some of those intelligence failures did involve state actor. Non-state actors are harder to try to determine the risk from. You don't even always know who they are. You don't know the motives necessarily. They may be speaking in languages or using communication channels that are just very difficult to determine. Some of these threats also, are just inherently difficult to forecast. Take the Arab Spring, for example. You know, this was essentially triggered by the actions of a lowly fruit seller in Tunisia. He set fire to himself. And I bet, the leader of Tunisia did not know that morning that he was at risk of losing his job that night or, later that week. So this is just an inherently harder task to try to warn about. And then, of course, you've got the non-agency threats, if you will, those that derive from biological processes, other sort of human interactions that are not as a result of someone deliberately trying to do harm to us. And they're even more hard to try to predict. And so if you're trying to sort of design a system to forecast this is inherently difficult. That's why I think it's better to focus on the risk. You can pull together the kind of circumstantial risk factors. You can monitor whether one is looking, more dangerous than the other, and produce a kind of overall picture of whether the likelihood of something is increasing or decreasing. You're not making a prediction. You're just saying that there is a shift in the evidentiary base, if you will, towards something happening. And therefore, that should trigger you to be more sensitive to it and improve your general level of preparedness in response to that. But it's a difficult thing, and we shouldn't assume that we can, develop sort of perfect forecasting techniques. And I think anybody who says that they can do that is selling a false bill of goods, frankly.
Right, let's take our first question from a member.
Certainly, we will take our first question from Joan Spiro.
Thank you for this interesting introduction. I'm wondering if there are any success cases. Are there situations where we have been able to identify a threat, where we have addressed it and have been able to mitigate the problem? Thank you.
Yeah, great question. I neglected to say that what we have done in terms of early warning hasn't been one long litany of failure. That we the systems that we put in place have helped, I think, on many occasions to warn of impending activities that pose a threat to us, and we have responded. And the stars have kind of aligned in those circumstances. I think we've often, had good warning when it comes to, for instance, the India-Pakistan crisis. I think in the early 90s, in fact, Richard Haass was involved in some of these efforts, in which we saw that the risk of a flare-up in Kashmir was growing, and we sent diplomats to the scene, and we were able to calm down what was going on. So that's an obvious case. I think there's been some potential coups in Africa that we anticipated, and we were able to see what was likely to happen through some intercepts or whatever. And we also were able to intervene and again, reduce the likelihood of things escalating and becoming dangerous. I can probably think of some other ones. I'm sure there have been many terrorist attacks that were thwarted because of our ability to detect them when they were being developed, or we saw them about to be launched, and we again thwarted them before they were successful. So it's not that. And I don't want to demean the terrific work that the intelligence community does and the dedication of many senior officials, that they are doing an excellent job and trying their hardest. And But it's just that on many occasions, as I mentioned, we have been blindsided, but that shouldn't diminish the fact that we've also been successful on occasions too.
Let's take the next question.
We will take our next question from Merrill McPeak. Please accept the unmute now.
Thank you, Paul, for an interesting pitch. Appreciate it. You just said something like, of the various kinds of threats we face, the state actors are the easiest to deal with. And you mentioned a long string of failures in regard to our ability to deal with even state actors. And you left out some good ones, by the way.
You should know, General McPeak, you're a professional, and so you are better informed than I about some of these threats.
Well, I would say the Chinese Army's intervention into Korea, which was a surprise to MacArthur, it still got me shaking my head. I don't know how we missed that one, but India's nuclear weapons test, in a way, the collapse of the Soviet Union, I mean.
Yeah.
And by the way, I don't see how we correct this by spending more money. We already, by an order of magnitude, spend a lot more money, collecting information than anybody else, maybe several orders of magnitude. So you suggested something different, that we take a different approach in this risk assessment business, but I wonder if you think we're well organized to do this work. And I don't mean just the 14 or 15 or X number of organizations that constitute the intelligence community, although that ought to be something we worry about also. But the fact that we've separated intelligence as though it were the commodity, an end product. Someone said, if to see and not to act is not to see. So we have separated the information from the people, by and large, who have the power to act on the information. It's always bothered me that we should take a boxer and blindfold him and put him in the ring and expect him to fight. But that's essentially what we've done with the intelligence community. Anyway, over to you.
So, people often refer to the church-state division between the intelligence community and the policy community. And it's a deliberate separation to avoid the politicization of intelligence, political biases and other things occurring. But the problem, as you allude to, is that it can be difficult for the intelligence community to convey what they're seeing, what they are understanding about developments, and convey to a skeptical group of policymakers who may be unfamiliar with the sources. They may be difficult to grasp what the significance of what they're seeing. And so I've always actually been in favor of the way the Brits do it, not just because I originate from the UK, but they have an organization called the Joint Intelligence Committee. And so that consists of both bureaucrats and senior intelligence officials that come up with a joint assessment to present to senior officials. And it's a way of conveying to senior officials why it's politically, not just militarily or otherwise, important to heed these warnings. And I particularly like that approach. And I've advocated in my book that something similar, an assessments directorate, a strategic assessments directorate, be formed in the NSC. What I'm worried about is that there's been a real, I think, rupture in relations between the policy community, the White House in particular, and the IC, which I think the next administration is going to have to try to bridge and restore mutual faith in each other. And that's going to be a big challenge, I think, there is a Biden administration. I would like to see some of the mechanisms that were employed in the past restored too. We used to have a National Intelligence Office of Warning, but that was dismantled, unfortunately. I would like to see a regular process in which the head of the National Intelligence Council can convene meetings when he or she believes there's a significant threat. I believe there also used to be a regular lunch meeting between the National Security Advisor, the Director of National Intelligence, and the Director of CIA, again, to have a kind of informal discussion about emerging threats, which was also very, very helpful. But all that, I think, has fallen by the wayside. So I think there are ways to bridge this divide that you refer to, General McPhee.
Let's take the next question.
We will take the next question from David Schaefer. Mr. Schaefer, please go ahead.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, hi, David.
Okay, great, I'm sorry. Great discussion, Paul. You know, I wonder if you could say something about in the information flow that comes across policymakers' desks with respect to prevention. What I never really saw come across the desk, in my experience, is a good psychological profile of those individuals who are posing the threat in terms of their leadership of governments or their leadership of militia, non-state entities, whereby policymakers in evaluating a prevention strategy would take into account a good psychological understanding of how the adversary or the threat actually thinks. What is his or her strategic way of thinking about things, and also just personality traits that would give you a much better sense of how to deal with the human beings involved in posing threats that you would have an opportunity perhaps to prevent?
Another great question. You know, my understanding is that CIA and maybe other parts of the intelligence community do psychological profiles, particularly in advance of summit meetings or conversations between the president and foreign leaders. They will sort of give a background on the person the president is speaking to. Whether there are, and I've heard of other sort of profiling at the agency in the past, and there are some folks around town that continue to do this, having been trained at CIA to do this. But whether that's still going on or whether it's a regular part of the preparation and information of decision makers, I just can't tell. I'm not privy to that. But I suspect it tends to be done more with senior leaders in foreign countries, and less when it comes to the leadership in sub-state groups or terrorist organizations, where frankly there may not be that much information. But I think you make a great point. It's not just the psychological profile, it's also their cultural background. We are, routinely, I think, guilty of mirror imaging, believe that others think and will act like us, when in fact, their personality or their cultural background will lead them to do something completely different.
Next question, please.
We will take our next question from Anders Aslund.
Thank you very much, Paul. A great presentation and very interesting theme. I would like to pose a rather unorthodox point. All these big bureaucracies are wrong. We have seen that CIA was wrong about virtually everything about the Soviet Union. And it was it thought that nothing was going on until 1990, didn't believe in Gorbachev's reform, and it was simply too big. You make your career in the CIA by being a good bureaucrat, not by being a good intelligence officer. While the best part that I see of US intelligence is the Bureau of Intelligence and Research at State Department and National Intelligence Council, because they are small and they think rather than deal with huge amounts of data that nobody can consider. So isn't this, you are sort of saying this in several ways, that we need to have a small group of intelligent people rather than 100,000 people sitting somewhere we don't know where.
Yeah. At the risk of offending a lot of friends in the intelligence community, I tend to agree with you. We spend a huge amount. You know, I don't think the American public, frankly, understands, in fact, it was a classified figure for many years, about how much we really spend on intelligence. I think it's close to, you know, 100 billion now, if not more, both the technical side, the analytical side, and so on. And it's that's a lot of money. And you know, whenever I visit Langley or I go to ODNI, and these are like huge university campuses, and you think, my God, what are these people doing? What, you know, how do they spend their day? Are there so many issues that requires this number of people working on them? How nimble can they possibly be? Are they, you know, duplicating work, competing with one another in a sensible way? So I kind of share your skepticism. INR has done remarkably well, as I think you and others know. It was one of the more skeptical voices in the lead up to the 2003 invasion of Iraq. They consistently questioned the analysis out of CIA and elsewhere about the state of WMD development in Iraq. And I think they are testament, as you say, to what a small informed group of experts who are seeped in a particular country and language and so on can accomplish. You know, I'm reluctant to say, well, we should just, as a result, you know, decimate the intelligence budget and only, you know, take it down to a few million. But nevertheless, I think there is a lot of duplication. Unfortunately, I'm not totally convinced that the reforms after 9/11 to create yet another layer of bureaucracy through the Director of National Intelligence was a good idea. It's just, say, added to a lot of, as you say, bureaucracy. I think, as General McPeat said, I think there's 17 organizations that make up the IC, and I think there's a lot of overlap and duplication in what they do. So I think there are ways in which we could streamline activities. But I hope that we can sort of look at this a little more rationally down the road. I wouldn't like, for instance, that my suggestions to create a kind of risk assessment approach creates yet another organization, or yet another set of bureaucrats to work on this. That should frankly come out of what exists now.
No, Paul, let me just follow up on that, because I think it's a really interesting story. You sort of said that in your remarks, you set out two areas where we fail. One is the intelligence failure. And I think Anders just had a really interesting point about bureaucracy and that leading to an intelligence failure. But the other you said was, you know, failure in the policy response. And there, could you talk a little bit about government structure, which ones are more vulnerable to a failure in policy response? And, you know, is democracy more vulnerable to a failure in policy response to some of these because you have political concerns, election concerns, you have divided government and the like? You know, are authoritarians better at this or not? You can see how China and others didn't get information, you know, on SARS or other things because people were scared to give bad news to those up the chain. But when they did decide to act, they were much better this time around in Wuhan, if we just look at the health thing. So talk a little bit about that policy response and how democracy is or isn't a strength or is a weakness.
So I think authoritarian governments are probably more exposed to errors of judgment that derive from intelligence and the politicization of intelligence. There have been famous cases in history in which authoritarian leaders have also been blindsided and victim of their own groupthink or biases. You know, Stalin before the invasion of Russia in 1941 is a classic case. And Saddam Hussein too, also, I think, was victim of his own biases and preferences and so on. So, you know, I think democracies are healthy in as much as that they create multiple sources of information and can debate in an honest fashion, hopefully, sources of intelligence and provide a balanced assessment. The problem is that, you know, if you have to sign off with a consensus assessment on something, you need to get 17 or so agencies all more or less agreeing. And we've seen this with what are known as NIEs, National Intelligence Estimates, that become this huge negotiation within the intelligence community. And people have, you know, annexes and footnotes with showing their dissent on certain things. So a senior leader reading this will wonder, well, what should I believe from this? Because there just seem to be too many competing voices. But I think on balance, that is still good than the opposite. Now, I think where authoritarian countries have more of an advantage is in terms, as you indicate, Shannon, of being able to move the government in a rapid, instantaneous fashion to deal with threats. And that can also have negative consequences as well. But on the whole, an authoritarian government tends to be a little more responsive and somewhat easier to steer than a democratic one with multiple arms of government and agencies all having to, you know, get in line and approve a certain line of effort. So I think there is a trade-off in that respect too.
Let's take another question.
We will take the next question from Jim Bergeron.
Hello. Thanks very much, Paul. I really enjoyed the conversation. Jim Bergeron, I'm a political advisor at NATO, the maritime headquarters outside London. I was particularly struck by your comment because it speaks to my life, which is that sometimes it's not INW lacking that is the problem, but getting the political response. And this was just addressed on the failure policy response discussion. But let me push it in one other small direction, which is the interesting problem when we're not in the Pearl Harbor model, where there isn't a certainty. There's a probability of harm coming, but not a certainty of it, but there are consequences to acting now. In your experience, how do we get this senior leaders and decision makers into the right space to deal with that? Because there are huge institutional pressures, you know, to not act until it's both obvious and late.
Right. Terrific question. I should have added that, you know, the challenge is even greater when you're dealing with warning and response in multilateral organizations and alliance frameworks like NATO. And there's a whole, I can give you the whole background on you know, some of the challenges that occur in these settings. But your point is a very good one, and is you know, why would decision makers be any more responsive to risk assessments than early warning information? And I think the key is to have essentially an a priori buy-in from decision makers about what they worry about in advance of the intelligence community warning them about, so that they have already conveyed to the intelligence community that their top threats or top risks are the following, that when the assessment comes out, they can rank them in terms of different tiers of relative priority. And so that when the assessment or the warning comes in and it's tagged with a certain level of priority in terms of its impact, that is more likely, I think, to get their attention. It's a little like, and I draw the kind of analogy with hurricane warnings, that, you know, if you issue a general weather report that there's going to be a bad storm coming, people will go, well, what does this mean? It could mean anything. What do I do? But if you say, actually, it's a category 4 hurricane or a category 3 hurricane warning, then people, that gets their attention. They know what to do. There's a whole kind of protocol to respond to those situations. And you know, institutions sort of are triggered and prompted to do certain things under that kind of warning. And I think you can do the same with risk assessments, so that decision makers are not kind of trying to figure out, well, why should I worry about this particular problem, and what have I got to lose? Why do I have to act now? If they have already understood that this fits into a certain category of warning. And I say a lot more about this in my book, and I'd be happy to follow up with you further on the reasoning behind my argument.
Thanks.
Great. Let's go on to the next question.
We will take our next question from Hani Findakli.
Thank you very much for this discussion, Paul. It's really very good. And I'm just wondering on these two issues of the intelligence failure versus the policy failure, whether the current structure that we have right now, and you are advocating the idea of creating some kind of a risk assessment mechanism, is the current structure flexible enough to allow for us to make that risk assessment possible? Or are the biases and the competition among the different agencies that are conducting intelligence work interfere with this process and slow down the process and make the response and the identification of the priorities of risk more of a random event rather than a one that we can assess more rationally?
So if I understand your question correctly, would this, the process that I advocate, would that be any less likely to be subject to the kind of cognitive biases and political or
No, I'm wondering whether it will solve the problem itself.
Sorry, say that again.
I'm wondering whether it solves that issue that brings those issues to the surface quicker and allows a more rational response.
So to me, it, as I say, it sensitizes decision makers of a latent risk before it is materialized into a formed threat. And so it allows them to basically understand the nature of the threat that they're worried about before it materializes. And I think there's obviously going to be differences of opinion about how to assess those, how likely they are, what impact they can have. But I think it's better to sort of have that kind of assessment before a crisis hits than during it, because that just slows you down, I think. And so, you're never going to eliminate that these kinds of inputs that could distort analysis. But I think if the system is set up in a certain way, you can reduce that. And as I said, I've seen this in the British case. I've seen this in the Australian and Canadian cases where they do have a more integrated assessment mechanism rather than the IC produces something, shoots it to the decision makers, kind of like the guy that used to deliver your New York Times onto your doorstep in the morning. That boy didn't know whether you were going to read it, much less open the paper from the package. Now, I think a more integrated approach would allow you to sort of reduce the challenge of convincing decision makers about the significance of the information they receive. I'll be happy to follow up on this with you, Anita.
Great. Well, we have reached, unfortunately, the end of our time, but I sincerely hope that whoever occupies the White House come next January listens to some of these ideas and restructures it. but Paul, I want to thank you on behalf of all of us for guiding us today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And just to add, Shannon, I'm always welcome to field questions by email and follow up with any of you if you have additional questions.
Great. So all of you who have more questions, please reach out to Paul. And for those of you who are in this masterclass series, please join us on November 10th with Sheila Smith, who will be talking about U.S.-Japan relations. So until then, everyone, please stay well.